I'm just saying, if you're going to let an individual keep the infrastructure to produce intratesticular testosterone and then subject them to just a cutoff of 288, when the average female produces like 40, it's f***ing ridiculous. So guys, Derek, MarkPlates28s.com. Today we're going to be talking about the trans weightlifter Laurel Hubbard. Again, it is almost time for the event to take place where she is going to fucking decimate the competition. And this article, I was tagged in by a few people. IOC praises trans weightlifter Laurel Hubbard for courage and tenacity ahead of historic Olympics debut. The IOC has hailed New Zealand weightlifter Laurel Hubbard for her courage and tenacity. Oh, I just fucking read that. It's the same as the title. Hubbard, 43 years old, is set to become the first transgender athlete to compete at the Olympics when she takes part in the women's 87 kilogram weightlifting on 2nd August at the Tokyo International Forum. However, the New Zealander's participation in women's weightlifting at Tokyo 2020 has sparked significant backlash online. Hubbard, who came out as trans in 2013, saw her position to compete at the Olympics supported by rule changes under the IOC in 2015. IOC Medical and Science Director Dr. Richard Budget said that everyone agrees that trans women are women. He insisted that Hubbard is competing under the rules of her federation ahead of her participation in the women's super heavyweight category. Speaking at a news conference on Friday, Budget said, to put in a nutshell, the IOC had a scientific consensus back in 2015. There are no IOC rules or regulations around transgender participation that depend on each international federation. So Laurel Hubbard is a woman, is competing under the rules of her federation. We have to pay tribute to her courage and tenacity in actually competing and qualifying for the games. IOC rules permit an athlete can compete in women's competitions if they have transitioned from male to female, even if they haven't had surgery to remove their testes. Fucking wild. But trans athletes must maintain that their total testosterone level is below 10 nanomoles per liter for at least 12 months ahead of a competition. So, as you can see, the 10 nanomole per liter cutoff, as we've described in the previous Laurel Hubbard videos, is 288 nanograms per deciliter, which, as you know, if you know reference ranges, is that this is literally a male territory level still. A woman would not produce more than even have a serum concentration of 70 nanograms per deciliter would be like the high end of a reference range. And then there are odd outliers like people with polycystic ovarian syndrome or individuals with hyperandrogenic environments induced through medical conditions and whatnot. But in general, unless you have like a fucking tumor or something, there's no way you're going to be exceeding a certain nanogram per deciliter cutoff, which is, you know, in the low 100s and even above and beyond that. Like, the advantage above and beyond a natural female is just absolutely astronomical when you actually just think about the structural advantages you have of going through puberty as a, you know, biological male and then subsequently transitioning, like, after many years of prepubescence, going through your fucking teenage years, and then being an adult for like a full decade, and then transitioning afterwards, once you've already built up the fucking structural integrity of thicker bones, fucking bigger hands, just like everything that comes along with being a biological male that you otherwise are going to retain when you transition to female. Now, of course, you're going to lose some muscle, you're going to lose some of that muscle strength and whatnot, and you're not going to retain everything, but as you, you know, fucking castrate yourself or whatever it is you choose to do as you transition, but you're going to retain a fucking lot of it, enough for it to be totally unfair. And the cutoff being 288 nanograms per deciliter is absolutely baffling, given that is literally four times the top end of a natural female's production, like a fucking hyper elite female, over four times the amount. And that's not even factoring in free testosterone levels, which are going to be disproportionately higher in males who do not produce binding proteins in nearly the same quantities as females due to the relative lack of estrogen production and stuff like this, consequently resulting in more freely circulating testosterone to induce action in tissues and whatnot. Now, for Laurel Hubbard in particular, obviously she has a significant amount of fucking leeway, given that she has not only the structural advantages of being a biological male who's then transitioned, but in addition to that, is somehow allowed to maintain a testosterone level over four times higher than a female, biological female who did not transition. And again, What's the average female going to produce? 40, 50 nanograms per deciliter, maybe, not fucking 70. So we're talking about 288 versus 70, plus all the structural advantages, the androgenic signaling that you've had in your brain for fucking years, like all of the shit that you've banked up, all the skill acquisition, all this stuff that you may not be able to replicate as a female that you can retain going into your athletic endeavors as a biological, you know, competing against biological females as a transition female, essentially. While Hubbard came out as trans, going back to the article now, as trans in 2013, she initially transitioned in 2012 after she underwent male puberty. Budget stressed the importance of inclusion at the Olympics and staunchly defended Hubbard against criticism of her going through male puberty. There are lots of aspects of physiology and anatomy and the mental side that contribute to an elite performance, he said. It's very difficult to say. Yes, she has an advantage because she went through male puberty when there's so many other factors that to take into account. It's not simple. Yeah, it fucking is, in my opinion. Each sport has to make their own assessment depending on the physiology of that sport so that they can ensure there's fair competition, but also inclusion of everyone, whether they're male or female, so they're able to take part in the sport they love. So, anyway, she's going to be competing. Let's see. Despite many advocates for transgender inclusion, some scientists have suggested that there is an advantage for those who have gone through puberty as a male since there is a greater chance of having a higher bone and muscle density. No way. Botched to reveal that the rules are reportedly set to be reviewed so that guidelines are more clear in the future, and said at the same time the IOC is in an inquiry phase with all different stakeholders to review these rules and to finally come up with some guidelines, which cannot be rules because this is a question where there is no one-size-fits-all solution. It differs from sport to sport. This is what all the athletes of the world are relying on, that the rules are being applied. The IOC president did not specify if he backed Hubbard's inclusion and instead reiterated the rules will constantly be reviewed. So yeah, like not only do you have everything you've gained through puberty, which females aren't going to have, they have higher estrogen levels, their growth plates close fucking sooner, they're not as tall, they don't have as thick of bones, their brains don't even develop in the same fucking way. There's so much shit that is not being taken into account here. And then on top of that, the fact that you're allowed to like subpar castrate yourself to 288 nanograms per deciliter and be qualified as a, you know, equivalent to a biological female, just absolute, it's absurdity. Now, in some of the events in the Olympics, the cutoff is lower, and you're like, you've got half of that at 5 nanomoles per liter. But again, there's still like, those situations are a lot more on the fence and ambiguous when you're talking about individuals with the chromosomal makeup of a fucking male versus like a literal biological female. Or when you have these individuals who may have like internal testes producing disproportionately higher amounts of testosterone. It's like, yeah, if you have like a fucking organ system that is completely superior to another female, but it's actually like a naturally produced thing, and you're sort of like a pseudo hermaphrodite to some extent. Yeah, there's a bit more ambiguity and there's more conversation to be had when you are like essentially you are a biological female, but you have like, you know, ambiguous sexual characteristics and whatnot versus someone who is literally a male for fucking decades, has gotten all of the full-blown advantages of a full-blown testosterone production, everything that comes along with the male developments and psyche, as well as going through sport in this fucking format, and then transitioning thereafter, and then smoking everyone in the Olympics. Is it like, you know, going from what apparently was a, you know, relatively average lifter to then becoming a fucking hyper-elite Olympic athlete as a female at post-transition, like, you know, I think that kind of speaks volumes on like where this individual should be competing. I don't think that it really makes a lot of sense for them to be competing against biological females. And to be honest, I think the real courage and tenacity would come against competing against biological males, if that's what you were fucking brought up as, you know? Like if testosterone has no impact on performance, then why not just castrate yourself and compete against males? Like, does that, like, is there not a logical like counter argument to this kind of scenario? Why is that not being proposed? It's kind of odd how these individuals will always compete against females, but then do you ever see biological females transitioning to male and then competing against males? Does not seem to be as prevalent. If, you know, if it is, I would love to see examples, but it does not seem to be as prominent from what I have seen in, you know, a high sport level or Olympic level or anything of that nature. Now, again, I'm not against somebody biological male, you know, transitioning to female and competing in general. I just think there should be a disparity between you know, some sort of segregation of classes where you have like biological females, they compete against biological females, biological males compete against biological males. And then somewhere in the middle, perhaps there is a middle ground of transitioning individuals, you know, like that sort of makes a bit more sense than having literal males transition to female and there's fucking smoke female athletes. Like, it does not seem to be fair, in my opinion. And I don't think it really has to do with how inclusive you are when it simply is not fair. You know, it's like if we had two cars, like in their drag racing, two Hondas, we have one with a NOS bottle, one without, one that has the literal ability to propel themselves down the track far faster than the other one. Is the driver of the non-NOS enhanced car just supposed to be fucking okay with the fact that their car is at a significant competitive disadvantage to the car with the fucking NOS bottle? They literally cannot compete with the machinery of this car, and yet they're supposed to be okay with it and just deal with it and lose. Like, how does that make any fucking sense? I don't understand. And again, it doesn't even come down to just the machinery. It comes down to the literal cutoffs being established are so blatantly unfair. It's like, okay, you can still keep your testes. I'm not advocating you have to fucking chop them off. I'm just saying, if you're going to let an individual keep the infrastructure to produce intratesticular testosterone and then subject them to just a cutoff of 288 when the average female produces like 40, it's fucking ridiculous, especially with all the other advantages. Like, even if you chop them down to 40 and we had equivalent total Ts, they still have the structural foundation that is far superior to that of a biological female, and there's nothing the fucking females can do about it. They're not going to be able to subject themselves to a decade of fucking DHT and testosterone exposure to then level the playing field. They've already gone through puberty. Their growth plates are closed. They can't get significant bone mineral density increases. They can't get fucking taller. They can't get bigger hands. They can't match this shit, and it simply is not fair, unfortunately. So I'm not sure why they're... You know, this is still, I don't even know why it's happening, to be honest. Like, it seems very unfair. Like, blatantly, clearly, it's unfair. I'm not sure how this was justified whatsoever. The real conversation to be had is around the intersex individuals. And that is, you know, where the real debate lies, in my opinion, which is, you know, the videos I did relatively recently on the sprinters that were, you know, banned from competition for levels of testosterone exceeding the, much lower cutoffs than what Laurel is allowed to get away with. And again, from what I understand, there are individuals saying that Laurel has subjected herself to slashing her testosterone down to like bare minimum nothingness, even though she has the leeway to go up to 288. You don't fucking know what she's doing. She could be keeping her test wherever the fuck she wants. She has a giant leeway to manipulate. And if you're trying to win the Olympics, would you not fuck around a bit and let yourself, you know, push the envelope a little bit? Or would you not, you know, like, how much fuckery can come into play too with exogenous testosterone manipulation when you literally are letting somebody who's female push their shit up to 288? Kind of insane, you know? Especially for an individual that could otherwise, you know, if they're castrating themselves for transitioning purposes and, you know, they have a fucking crashed LH and FSH as well, like, trying to interpret biomarkers and shit when you are drug testing an individual who is transitioning, like, so much more manipulation can come into a play and there's so much leeway for cheating. It's absolutely absurd. But even if everything was equated testosterone level wise, Laurel would have such an advantage from a structural aspect that it's just not even fucking funny. So I don't know why, again, why she's being praised for her courage and tenacity, I guess, you know, to deal with the hate, perhaps, I get, like, I don't know. It's like, to me, it seems just unfair. And I'm not sure how Laurel feels it's fair to subject, to delegate biological females who've trained for this their entire lives, like, totally slaughter them and basically just knock them all down one place in their rankings and be okay with it. Like, to me, that seems like, it seems baffling that I could literally go take a fuck ton of tren, test whatever the fuck I want for the next couple of years, crank my goddamn mind out, come off, clean out for a bit, transition to female, and go enter in a competition like this and work my way up and some, you know, become a, you know, an athlete that competes against biological females. Like, I could literally be sitting here fucking cramming my ass with tren bologna sandwiches and then clean out, go compete in some sort of event as a, you know, transitioning male to a female. And again, I'm not trying to shit on the, you know, transitioning or anything like that. I'm just saying from an actual performance aspect, it's baffling that I could do that. I could literally take trenbolone, testosterone, fucking anything I want, and then decide to transition over a decade after going through puberty, after all this shit, you know, being a full-blown adult who has all these structural advantages of being a male who's been subjected to high topped out levels of testosterone DHT for fucking decades at this point, and I can take whatever the fuck I want and then literally come off, you know, decide I want to transition and then go compete against biological females. Is that fair? You know, it does not seem too fair to me. Now again, all about inclusivity. I just think they need to segregate the divisions a little bit further to have a bit more, maybe one more subsection perhaps at least would be, you know, a viable alternative, I feel like, at least better than the current situation. But I don't know, I guess we will see. And presumably Laurel is going to absolutely decimate the competition, but you never know. I guess we will see, and we'll see how much of an advantage or disadvantage she has. Like, I don't know. Let me know what you guys think in the comments down below. All the comments help the algorithm. They're much appreciated. Like, subscribe, check out my blog, moreplates28s.com. Follow me on Instagram, at moreplates28s. Facebook, Snapchat, Twitter, TikTok, Apple Podcasts. If you want to support the channel, you can check out anything I'm associated with in the video description below. My TRT clinic, it's all telemedicine from the comfort of your own home. Gorilla Mind, nootropic formulas, Gorilla Mode, pre-workout formulas. I design myself from scratch. My recommended lab tests and diagnostics. Stay on top of your health. Recommended diet model for gaining muscle and strength and sports performance, as well as anything else I'm associated with. It is all in the video description below. Thank you guys for watching. Talk to you soon.